Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Feel Free Again podcast. I'm your host, Cole James, and today I am joined by a very special guest. She goes by Laura Rodas, and she is, I believe, our second international guest so far on the show. Laura and I met years back. She was part of one of my certification trainings. She has an incredible story. She's an incredible person, and she has some really big goals and with grief recovery, and she has got a huge heart and she's super talented. And so I wanted to have her on to talk about wherever this conversation goes. So without any further ado, Laura, welcome to the podcast. I am glad you're here with us.
Yes, me too. I am very excited.
If you don't mind telling the audience a little bit about how you got into this line of work, kind of what your personal story is, what brought you to this method?
I have a degree on marketing, and I used to have a very successful business doing corporate events, and I was in the corporate world. But one day, my husband, my whole life is around him, right? I met him when I was 17. We dated for 5 years, and then we got married, and then we were married for 6 years. And I had my entire life figured out with him, like when I was gonna have kids, and we're gonna do this, and we're gonna that. And I had all these hopes, dreams, and expectations for our life together. But one day he was in politics, and he went into another country, and he was assassin in this other country. Mm. And right there just changed my entire life, and everything that I had thought that my life was going to be, it just ended right there. And in that moment, I knew that I wasn't going to survive this. I knew it. I knew that my life had ended with him. So I remember searching and searching because I was never like a religious person or anything. And I wasn't sure if I was gonna go into heaven. And I knew that my husband was in heaven. So I started searching and looking, and I had a sister in the States, and I said, hey, tell me, like, what do I have to do to go into heaven? And I remember going into a pastor in my country, and I said, hey, so this is what's going on in my life, and I need to know what are the steps I need to take to go to heaven. And I remember him, I remember his office, him saying to me, okay, you need to start speaking in tongues. And I was completely lost. Like, wait, I don't even understand the difference between Jesus and Christ and the Holy Spirit. How am I supposed to start speaking in tongues? And that for me was like step 15, and I didn't even know where the stairs were at.
Right. Wow. Yep. Wait, that's, I love how you articulated that. Okay. Please continue.
And so my sister in the States, she would go into a church in the States. And I said, hey, so this guy is telling me that I need to speak in tongues, and I don't know how to do it. So I'm going to fly over there and just show me the way. So I flew to the States, and I went into this whole new church. And that was like my way to go to heaven, right? At the same time that I'm in the States, my sister knew about grief recovery through a friend of hers. And in that time, I would like try to fly away my country all the time. Like I was running away from being here because everything was so public and out there. So I would fly to the States like every other weekend. And in one of those trips that I did, she gave me the handbook. And I remember coming back and just having the book with me at that time, because I was so sad and because I was devastated from everything that was happening, not only the death of my husband, but all the craziness around it and everything being so public, that I was going with a psychiatrist, and I was taking all this kind of meds that they were giving me. I remember there are so many things that I don't remember because of everything that I was taking. So
all the medication?
All the medication, yes.
Okay.
I remember that I would, my friends, like years later, they told me, like, after 6 p.m., we could be with you and be talking to you, and you were just not there. And then the next day, I couldn't remember that I was with my friends. Like, we were going to restaurants, and I would, like, literally just fall asleep right there and just, you know, like a zombie.
Yep.
Yeah, like a zombie.
Yep. So, and in terms of your journey, right, how kind of this time frame when you traveled to the States and your sister got you a copy of the book, how long after the loss of your husband is this roughly?
This is like a month or 2 months after his loss.
Wow. Okay. So yeah. this is still all very, very recent, very, very fresh.
Very raw. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And so, and from there, kind of, please continue. From there, you're on a lot of medication from your psychiatrist. You have this book, and you're traveling quite a bit to just kind of, you know, again, escape. Probably just not be in that reality, right?
Right.
Escape.
Yes.
Exactly. Okay. Please continue.
Yes. So I remember it was like, I don't know, maybe like almost a year or like 10 months. That I, like, my days, I couldn't work because I was so zombie with all the pills that I was taking, all the medication.
Yeah.
So my days would go by me going to this pastor, to the psychiatrist, and just, like, lying in bed, completely useless.
Yeah.
So I remember having the handbook. I remember reading about, like reading the steps. But I'm like completely away from people because I'm hiding in my house. I'm hiding in my room. So
yeah.
It's just me, myself, and the handbook. So I remember like reading it. I remember not being sure about if I was doing it right or not. I didn't have a guide with me, or I didn't have a specialist or someone who would tell me, yeah, you're doing it right. This is the way, this is what you're supposed to do.
Yep.
And especially because I was so out of, like, not myself, not being able to remember and just surviving each day, literally.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah.
And where, and by the way, just for the audience, Laura and I have worked together. I've heard her story before. So I'm aware of parts of her story. I'm, you know, not aware of other parts of her story. So I just want the audience to kind of know that. So in terms of when did the pivot happen, or what happens next, I guess, in your story, right? Where was the shift towards kind of what we would call moving towards recovery?
So I went into this church. I escaped, I escaped from my reality going into this religious moment in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And I was there like under a rock, you know, like just trying to feel safe in my environment and trying to feel whole as a human being. Eventually, I knew that I couldn't keep on taking so many medications because I couldn't do anything. So I remember that I was going into this psychiatrist, and one day he just said something to me that I had like a moment of like myself. And I said,
because
just so that you'd understand, this is like craziness going on around me, right? Craziness, like out there, like people being crazy towards me. So I tell the psychiatrist, like, hey, this is what's happening, and I don't think that's normal. And I remember him saying, like, hey, this is an opportunity for you. You have to see this as an opportunity. And I remember in that moment I said, why is he saying this to me? It doesn't sound right. So I remember leaving that doctor. And I said, I'm never coming back here. So I went and I searched for another psychiatrist. And when I went with him, I said, hey, I need to stop taking so many pills. I don't want to be on medication anymore. And I'm not here to talk about his death. I'm not here to talk about my grief. I just want to get over this medication. And that took me like a whole year to get over that. So
wow. And let me just say this real quick, Laura. Sorry to interrupt. This is very, very, very common with widows. I have heard so many stories about widows specifically being put on medication. If that is the tool or the solution that your professional has for you, run away as fast as you can.
Yes.
Grief is normal and natural. Okay. And grief does not need to be treated with pharmaceutical drugs.
Yes.
We're getting into Laura's story, and thank you for courageously telling the truth about your story, Laura. Right now you're a year in and you're basically addicted to drugs, right?
Yes.
Like, let's just call it what it is.
Yeah.
Because you trusted people that are supposed to be the authorities in your world, you know, on how to navigate this very normal and natural reaction to the loss of your husband, and your heart is in 1,000 pieces for this loss that you did not want, that you did not see coming. And the answer is, here is a bottle full of things made in a laboratory, and just keep stuffing them down your throat.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
It is so tragic, and it makes me so angry. So I just want to say that to all of our widows out there listening, run away if the solution to your grief of the loss of your husband is, here, take a bunch of these like man-made things in a bottle, because I have no other solution for you. Right.
Yes.
But anyway, so I just wanted to, so you're like you're now like a year and a half into your grief.
Yes.
And you're basically now seeking doctors to help you get off of medication. Right.
Right.
So
yes.
Anyway, please continue.
Yes. So eventually I get off medication and I start, and I'm able to drive again because I was so drugged by everything that I couldn't function as a human being. So I was able to drive again. I was able to go back to work and to start getting my life together. But once again, since it was so public, I would like really like just keep away from people in general. Like I stopped going into a supermarket and like doing the simple and normal things that people do, just because I would get recognized by what had happened to me.
And right. So your story, right, in your country, was very public, right? So you can't,
yes.
You don't even have the benefit of grieving, in yeah. privacy, right? You're grieving kind of in the national spotlight.
Yes. Yes.
Wow. I can't even imagine. I'm sending you a hug right now, Laura.
Thank you.
Okay. So you're, you know, okay, please continue. You're just trying to even go out in public and you can't.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
So, eventually, you know, time goes by, the years go by. I remember that I always had the curiosity about the book and the handbook, and like something was like a seed was planted in my heart or in my somewhere. And I remember like always just having like the curiosity about, did I get it right? Did I complete it? Because I, you know, everything was so fuzzy because of all the medication that I was taking.
Sure.
So time went by, and because I always had that curiosity, one day I went in line, and I was like, okay, I felt like a human being again, and I felt like normal. And so I went in line. I went into the site of the grief recovery method, and I started looking for dates for a certification. And then I just applied and I flew to the States and I met you. Yeah.
Yeah. How many years back was that, Laura? Do you remember?
Yes. That was like 8 years after his death.
Okay. Yeah. 8 years after his death. Mm-hmm. And okay. And so we, You know, and I remember, it's so wild, my memory, in terms of sometimes I don't remember names, right? But I always remember people's stories, right? It's just been ingrained in me, being trained by my dad and Russell and all these amazing trainers. Like, you need to be in the moment when people are telling you their truth about their story, right? So anyway, I remember like it was yesterday, our training. I couldn't tell you what city we were in. I couldn't tell you what the hotel was like, but I remember you, like, specifically, right? So, okay, so you get there, and this book, the seed was planted by you getting the book very early on in your grief process. But, you know, again, these professionals that should be taking care of you instead tried to get you addicted to drugs, right? That's, I'm just going to be blunt about it because it makes me so angry. By the way, my mom, who's a recent, you know, widow, married to a man for 40 years. And what's the first thing that her doctor tries to get her on, right, up here, when she comes to visit me, and she's there for a cold, right? And then the next thing this guy wants to do is get her on drugs because she's grieving, right? So it just infuriates me. So sorry, I'm going to keep going back to that throughout this episode probably. But anyway, so you get to the grief recovery and certificate. Just to, go ahead. Yeah, please.
And just to add to what you're saying, I mean, now that I see it, and now that I'm, you know, life went by, and now that I think about it, I mean, of course I was going to be sad. Of course I was going to be devastated. Of course that I was going to be crying. I mean, it's normal, but I would have preferred to live it through and just, like, I don't know, cry and just remember, you know, that there's so many things that I can hardly remember, and that I know the story because someone else told me, because I wasn't able to remember, because I remember I was taking two pills that they were like, one is like almost near to morphine. Okay. So I wish I could remember so many things that I can't. And because I remember reading the thing of the prescription in one of the pills that I was taking. And one of the side effects was the loss of a memory from, and I'm talking about years before and years after. Yep. That I just have like nips about it and not like the entire story. And maybe if I start talking to someone, like a friend of mine or something, I'll be like, yeah, I can kind of remember, but yeah, it's just fuzzy. Yeah. And so now, so I just wanted to say that, like, now that I think about it, of course I was going to be devastated and heartbroken and
Exactly. And that's where it's like, grief is normal and natural, right? We lose someone we love, our heart is broken. Mm-hmm. That does not require, right? We for hundreds of thousands of years, we've known how to emotionally process that in various levels, various degrees of emotionally processing that, right? And so again, just the idea that it's like, oh no, we can just have pills that help you numb it, help you lose your memory, help you just kind of drool and basically not even be in the moment. It's so evil. Like, again, I don't know how else to say it, because, like, for you, I love that you, for whatever reason, right, you got off of those drugs, which I'm so happy about. And I'm so happy that my mom had me to come home to and say, that doctor's insane. You're never seeing him again, mm-hmm. right? You're definitely not taking anything he's trying to prescribe you right now, you know, because it's normal and natural what you're going through. I love that those are the story. That's the story for you. That's the story for my mom. Think about how many thousands of widows get addicted to these medications and have to take them the rest of their life. And then that leads to other things. And then that leads to other medications, or that leads to more drinking, or, you know, whatever. But it's like, it is horrifying what we are doing to our grieving people worldwide. Mm-hmm. Right. It is criminal, in my opinion. Right. Because what we're all dealing with is normal and natural, and it can absolutely be worked through with very healthy, normal and natural processes, right? Like this one and others. But again, so anyway, thank you for telling the truth about that. So let's jump over to, you're now in the certification, because you've always wondered, okay, I don't know how much I remember from that book. I don't know if I did it right. You know, I'm curious about this. So you go on the internet, you find us, you show up, and now you know, I happen to be your instructor in that weekend. And take us through that, if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm. So because I felt like a person again, I'm like, okay, now that I am sane and able to function, I want to help other people, because it took me way too many years to feel complete again. So I want to.
But Laura, I thought time just heals everything, right? I thought, you know, a couple of years passed, so you're good, right? Your time just healed everything?
No, that's BS.
Okay, that's BS too. I agree. All right, sorry, go ahead. Please continue.
So I'm like in this mindset, it's like I'm going to go and I'm going to help other people, and I'm just there to learn, because I'm already like fine. And
right.
Yes.
Yeah. And by the way, a lot of people come to our certification with that mindset, and that's perfectly okay. Now, yes, that will shift very quickly in the training, because we are going to go look at our stuff, but I think that's probably where you're going with this story. But again, go ahead.
Yeah. So I'm in there, and I remember I'm going into like graphing my life and just seeing it like in front of me. And the logical thing was for me to work on the death of my husband, right? This is like my intellect is telling me, well, my biggest loss is my husband, so I'm going to work on that. But then being there, and because I didn't know that I was going to do personal work, and being there, I realized that I have another huge loss. That was the relationship with my mom, my living mom. I mean, she's alive. She's still alive. And it was just like this bizarre moment that just, I don't know, it just made everything make complete sense to me, because I've always had like a rocky relationship with my mom.
Yep.
And I didn't know that it was a thing, like an issue in my life, until I was in the certification and I saw.
Wow. So let me stay here for one second, because I want to explain to the audience, right? It's like the Grief Recovery Handbook, again, I love it, right? I think my dad wrote it all these years ago, and it's incredible, comma, right? That is much different than working with a certified grief recovery specialist in your community. It's much different than working with me in a certification training, because kind of what I hear you saying, correct me if I'm wrong, but you had the book, you've been through the book, you understand that the book applied to your husband, the death of your husband, but it wasn't until you were actually at the certification that you realized that you have massive unresolved grief with your living relationship with your mother.
Correct.
Is that accurate? Right. So, So the book alone did not get you to that aha moment. It took you being in a room with kind of a trained professional, really diving deeper than the book can, because, you know, again, let's face it, the book was written specifically at a sixth grade reading level, because we understood that grievers have a reduced ability to concentrate. So we wanted to make it very simple. But even when it's that simple, a lot of us as grievers are, again, put on medication, or we just have trouble concentrating because we're out of the moment a lot of just grieving. And so the book can't be any more kind of complicated than it is, because we want the contents of that book to be absorbable for people, right? So that people can kind of like get the concepts. But even then, you know, we can only do so much with the book alone. So again, all this is to say, if you're listening to this podcast and you're interested in this method, and you want to do your own personal work, please find a grief recovery specialist in your area, or attend one of our workshops with the Institute, right? It's all the same method. It's delivered in various ways, but it will help you see stuff you've never seen before. So anyway, Laura, please continue. I love this though. So you're in the training and you realize, look, everyone in the world would say, Laura, you're here to do the work on your husband, right? But in your heart, which is all that matters, right? Not the rest of the world and the work you need to do. Your heart is saying, wow, I did not see. I have been grieving my relationship with my mother for a long, long time, even though she's living. And no one really would catch that except for the Grief Recovery Institute would be like, oh, no, you've been grieving this relationship. And so anyway, go ahead.
Yes. So, yes, you said it perfectly. So I'm in there, and I remember like seeing in my graph like the very two vivid losses, right? My husband and my mom. And my mom is like in so many, like I, and it's curious because I wasn't raised with my mom. I was raised with my dad. And they got divorced when I was like 3 years old. And so she was like around, but not very close to me. So, but it was there. It was there when I had a light bulb in my head and said, whoa, there's so many things that I'm carrying with my relationship with her. So there's so much unresolved grief that I have towards her. And yeah, I did my work on my mom. And let me tell you that if it wasn't because of the grief recovery method, I don't know where I will be right now. Wow. With the relationship with my mom. I honestly don't know. Yeah.
Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. I love that. I have seen so many people do incredible work in improving their relationships with their parents, right? I know I've worked on both my mom and dad, right? And at the time I worked on both of them, they were both living, right? And then my dad has since passed away, right? So then I had more work to do on the loss of him, the death of him. But I always really just beg people to do the grief recovery method on their parents, right? Cool, my parents alive. Yeah, absolutely. Still do this work, right? It's incredible the kind of gifts we get in our relationships with our parents if we do this work. So anyway, so you don't know where you would have been without this work on your mom. Can you talk a little bit about what the changes were in that relationship? Like what did the method get you in that relationship with your mom?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that for most of my life, I had wished for a different mom. I mean, a sure. more loving mom, sure. a more present mom, a more caring mom. And I think that I always felt that this time she's going to show up. This time is going to be different. This time, you know, and I always had that hope. But that never happened. So it was a disappointment after another disappointment after another disappointment. So what shifted was my expectations of her, of my relationship with her. And it helped me just become complete with what I had without anything changing in her or in our relationship. It's just a change inside of me. And that made...
Wow. Beautifully said. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that made,
yeah. What were, yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
No. And that made a huge, huge difference for me because it helped me let go of the expectations of something was going to change and that eventually I was going to have that caring, loving, present mom. And no, it hasn't happened. And that was in that moment. But ever since that moment until today, my mom's still the same person. I mean, she's still the same human being. And what has helped me throughout these years after working on her, on my relationship with her, is just I am now able to process every situation. I mean, I am now able to process everything. And that for me is priceless. I mean, it's priceless. And
yeah, it's really interesting. Like, and this has been true for me in my relationship with my mom and my relationship with my dad. I did the grief recovery method on them. And like you said, right, if you can get your expectations down to, I have no expectation they're going to change at all. They're just going to be who they're going to be. But if I can go and grieve and complete, you know, 20, 30 years of unfinished emotional stuff that I've accumulated with my mom. If I can like say goodbye to that stuff, if I can let that go, if I can forgive her for some stuff and I can apologize for some stuff and, you know, I can also identify some really significant emotional statements I have her. If I can do all those things, then literally the next time I interact with my mom after doing the grief recovery method on her, the energy is way different. mm-hmm. way different, right?
Yes.
The way I approach things, the way I receive messages or, you know, communications from her, there's less sting and stuff, right? There's more unity and stuff. There's more love there. And I'm not saying that every time we do this work on a parent, the outcome is like warm and fuzzy and we're closer. You know, I know many people who have done this work on their parent and then said, finally, you know what, I'm done trying to go to this well and get water because all I'm going to ever get from this well is poison. Mm-hmm. And for the safety of myself and for my spouse and for my children, the answer is now I'm very clear that I can't have a relationship with this person.
Right.
So, you know, it can sometimes be that outcome too. But on the other side, I have seen people that viewed their mom or dad as these really kind of evil people. And they kind of tended to have that overshadow every other part of that, you know, parent. And through grief recovery, they found more good. They found more love. They found, you know, a way to actually operate in a relationship with that parent. And I know that's kind of your story.
100%.
But I want to identify again, just reiterate what you said. Your mom didn't have to change at all. And in fact, she didn't change at all. Laura changed. Laura did the work to change your heart around your perception of your mom, your expectations on your mom, all those kind of things, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's such a gift. And that's, I would say, the most underutilized thing in the grief recovery method is not nearly enough people, including people that have been through the grief recovery method, but, you know, out there in the world in general, not enough people apply this work to their living relationships, mm-hmm. right? It's such a gift. It's such a gift.
Yes. And just to add to what you're saying, that's completely what happened to me. I mean, before I did my work with my mom, I would see her like this evil person towards me, right? But I was able to see the good in her and the raw things in her, but to see it as a whole, you know, like a whole relationship. And something like very simple that really changed in me. Like before, I would see my mom would call me on my phone and I'll be like, ugh. And this is my reaction. Like, I'm just rolling my eyes inside of my heart. I'm like, ugh. But after working my relationship with her and throughout these years, it's so different. I mean, the energy that I have towards her, it's so different. I mean, she can still be herself, but since I don't have expectations anymore, and I'm just like, okay, bring it on. And in a different perspective and in a different place for me, it makes a whole difference. My mom right now, she like for the last maybe, I think ever since the pandemic, she has started to lost her memory.
Mm.
And it's so curious because now she has like sometimes, I don't know what kind of dementia, but and I'm going to be super honest about it. Now it's easier to get along with her because she forgets everything and she's not going to be like complaining or just fighting with you about something because she can't remember. And now I am able to be more present for her and I don't know, to have a different relationship with her because of the grief recovery method. Yeah. I mean, that's 100% truth in my life.
What a gift, right? What a gift. What a gift to travel to the States to do the certification training because we want to help other people. And then within the first day or two, realize, wow, this is an opportunity for me to do work on my mom, which I wouldn't have seen without, you know, being educated on some stuff we're not taught. And then do that work. And then that work helps you improve your relationship with your mother for years and years and years to come. Right? How many people don't have that opportunity simply because they don't have access to these tools, right?
Right.
So what a gift to be able to do that work for you. You know, I love that. Mm-hmm. So if you don't mind, let's pivot over to, you now have this certification. Because one of the things I love about you, Laura, is, you know, again, the certification that weekend is different for different people, right? But what I love for you is you really did take this certification and then go and put in the work to help other people, right? So if you don't mind, let's get into a little bit about you becoming a grief recovery specialist, right? And you applying these tools and helping others. You know, what has that been like for you?
It's been amazing just because I went through it. So I'm like a living proof that the method works, right? And because I've lived through it, I'm like, you gotta try this. So I remember coming back to my country, I'll be like, you need to do this, and you need to do this, and you need to do this. And I would do it just like randomly to like people around me. Yes. And eventually, and at this time, I had my company. So I remember like having a very successful event, corporate event that I would have planning for the past 2 years, and like this huge success and whatever. And I will be like, yeah, you know, this is another event. The next one is going to come, and just one through another and another and another. But when I used to be working with people doing the grief recovery method, my soul would be like, I don't know, just light it up. And so I started like, this is something that I want to do. I want to do this every day of my life. I want my life to have meaning and to just get to see these aha moments and this change and just, I don't know, just help people have the opportunity that I had for a plan B.
Yeah, that's very similar to my story too, right? I think you know, but I was in the corporate world and I was having a fine career doing that. And then I went to one of these certifications as well. And then I started using, you know, this work on the side, and I saw what it was doing for people. And I was like, this is more fulfilling for me. This is what I want to dedicate my life to, you know? So I love that. So you're getting in this work. You're obviously passionate about telling people about the work because you've experienced what it's done for you, right? And then the other thing I love about your story, Laura, is obviously this book is written in English originally. And now the book's in over 25, 26 languages, I think, which is amazing, right? We're right now, currently, we're working on the Japanese translation, which I'm so excited about because I'm trying to figure out how to weave that into a snowboarding trip for me, right? It's like, I have to go check this translation, snowboard in Japan, which has been a dream of mine for a long time. But anyway, I digress. But my point is like, you would call me from time to time after the certification and be like, you know, hey, the translation here is weird, or in Spanish, we don't have this word, or, you know, I don't quite know how to work, you know, and let me say this, like, shout out to Arturo Albin, and the whole team, the grief recovery team in Mexico City. Arturo happened to be, and his wife, Alejandra, we've lost her. She passed away, but, I met them at my first certification training, like the two of them. And I love them both dearly. And I love Arturo, and he's done incredible stuff to help get this to the Spanish speaking world. So I just want to shout out to Arturo. I'm definitely going to have him on the podcast at some point. You know, but Laura, you're another kind of pioneer in the space of getting grief recovery to the Spanish speaking world. You know, I know that's a goal of yours. So can you walk me through a little bit about, you know, were there adjustments that need to be made? Are there adjustments that are made for you when you're working through the grief recovery method with people who speak Spanish primarily, right? Like, I know for you, the first time you did this work, you were certified with me. And so you had to do the personal work, the graph, you know, the letter, all the stuff we do in our work, you had to do in English, you know, with your mom. And I know you have some takeaways from doing it in English, which is not your native language, right? Mm-hmm. And kind of more of what you prefer. So can you kind of talk on any of that, anywhere you want to go with that?
Mm-hmm. Well, yes. And first of all, in Spanish, there's the word grief. It you can't translate it. I mean, to say grief, you have to say like seven different words. So because there's not like a translation that it's so true to grief, right? It's more in English is more like abrupt. I don't know how to explain mm-hmm. that to you. And throughout the years, so every time I've done, I got certified as an advanced specialist, and every time I will do this, throughout the years, I discover that, yeah, but this doesn't feel like close to my heart. It's like, I felt like there are, because I've worked so many relationships. I mean, now I'm like, I don't want to carry anything inside of me. I don't want to carry any unresolved grief. It doesn't matter if it's someone close to me or not important to me. I don't want to have like bad feelings. And I'm always like graphing people all the time.
And another way to put that, right? I love that. Another way to put that is we don't, if you do this work for long enough, you really don't like having incompleteness in relationships. Yes. You don't like to have incomplete feelings with people, whether that's friends, colleagues, your spouse, your children. And so when you feel that incompleteness, you know what that feels like, and you don't want to keep holding that, right? So that's what Laura is saying right there. Yes. But anyway, go ahead.
Yes. Yep. So every time I do I work on a different relationship, I do it in Spanish. And that's when like everything hit for me. I mean, to think about, so yes, I have my takeaways, and of course that the method worked with me, doing it in English. But when I do it in Spanish, it's just different. It feels different for my heart, because it's just, I mean, my dad died on like a few years ago, and he died on a Tuesday. I was working my grief in my relationship, my unresolved grief with him, the next Monday, because wow. I didn't want to have that with me, right? And and I remember, of course, doing that in Spanish, because I've never talked to my dad in English ever. So the way that I would express myself and just talk to him would be in Spanish. So even though I think that even though you can be bilingual in any language, but your heart and your emotions are in my native language.
It completely makes sense that people want to do grief recovery method in their native tongue, right? From time to time, I have to do all these different types of certifications, sometimes in different languages. So you'll have to have translators sitting in the room, right? So shout out to anyone that's had to do grief recovery through, you know, multiple translators and really awkward time zones. I mean, we've done this in Russian, and we've done this, we're about to do this in Japanese, and that is way, way harder than being able to do it in your native tongue. So it makes complete sense where you're like, yeah, I never spoke to my dad in anything but Spanish. Of course I want to do the grief recovery method with him in Spanish, right? I love that. So anyway, please continue again, wherever you want to go with the adjustments you've made or the things that, you know, I'm excited to announce too here in a little bit, like what kind of Laura is doing on our team as well. But again, take it away, Laura. Tell me, because you've done the work in English, but you've also done the work in Spanish, right? So talk to us about that more.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, in my case, for me to do the work in Spanish, it's closer to my heart. It's closer to my soul, and I'm able to express everything that is incomplete for me in my own language.
When you work with clients, do you give them the option, or is it pretty much like, we're going to do this work in Spanish, right, in your country?
Well, there's a lot of people who are like Spanglish.
Uh-huh.
And so I like, and it happens to me when I'm speaking in Spanish, like I would know the word, but it's better in English. And yeah, I just throw out there a few words in English, but I've worked with a lot of people who do the same, and that a word is more, it's easier to explain in English than into Spanish.
Yep.
So since I'm bilingual, they're able to do that, and it just works perfectly.
Wow, yeah. That's great. So if you're working with people who are bilingual, you'll kind of flow and find words out of either English or Spanish that are fitting for that moment, or, you know, helpful to explain, or, you know, that's amazing. Yeah, that's great. And then obviously if you work with people who are just Spanish speakers, you have that tool to work with them in Spanish. And then if you're working with just English speakers, you can do it there. But I really like that hybrid too, right? I've attempted to be a bilingual person for a long time. Unfortunately, I'm not. And so I never thought of that you could actually use words out of either language when it's appropriate, right? Or when it makes sense for your client. That's cool.
Yes, yeah. Yes, it is.
So the next place I want to go again, just because we're really excited to announce this. I don't think we've really announced this publicly yet, but if you go to griefrecoverymethod.com under the certification tab, if you're interested in getting certified in this method, again, to do your own personal work, to help others with the work that they need to do, it's just this incredible experience and program we offer, right? And the support we offer is I don't think you can really compare it to anything else. I mean, what we're willing to do to help you get started and continue to help people is pretty remarkable. But anyway, you know, Laura identified, hey, you know, she approached me years back and said, hey, Cole, you know, there's a lot of people in the U.S. that want to get certified, that their native language is Spanish. And really the work is best done if you can do it in Spanish, because it speaks to our hearts, because we're Spanish speakers. And I was like, you know what, that makes a lot of sense. So Laura has put in the work to become a trainer with us, right? And that's several years of training, right? After you already have quite a bit of experience out there in the field working with grievers, then we kind of take you under our wing, and then we have our trainers help get you to the trainer level, right? And there's only, I don't know, maybe 10 to 15 trainers worldwide that really are at that level. And so it's a real honor and privilege for me to announce that Laura is one of our trainers, and we're going to start doing certification trainings that are led. All the work is done completely in Spanish, right? And so we will offer our certification to Spanish speakers that would prefer going through all of this method in Spanish, right? And Laura, you're going to be one of the instructors to do that. Again, if you're in Mexico, you can also go and work with Arturo over there. Método Grief. I'm going to mess this up. Laura's already made fun of how I say Método Grief Recovery. We'll put this in the show notes. But if you want to work with Arturo there in Mexico and get certified, he's incredible. Their team's incredible there too. And then also, if you want to work with us here in the States, you know, maybe you live in Miami or LA or Texas or, you know, anywhere really in the United States, but you're just thinking, you know what, I would prefer to get certified in Spanish, or I'm going to work with a lot of Spanish speaking clients. And so I really want to know how to help that community. You know, we have dates on the calendar so that you can do that, so you can get certified in Spanish. So again, Laura, congrats. I'm so excited that you're on the team doing that with us. And you're just an incredible, incredible facilitator of this work. And so I have no doubt that you're just going to do great work certifying people in Spanish. So any thoughts on that, or, you know, any kind of, I don't think we've really talked about this yet on the podcast. How was that process of becoming a trainer? You know, how was that? Because that's kind of unique.
Yes, that was kind of unique. Especially because I got trained, because all of the training that I was doing, they were all in English. So once again, I'm like learning everything in English. And now I have the job to say the same, everything that I know in English, but to say it in Spanish, right? And that happened to me before when I got certified with you, that, okay, this is like, I would do the work and just be, okay, so this is the idea in English, to tropicalize or to say this in Spanish will be like this. And I would like be asking, okay, does this make sense in Spanish? If you're not bilingual, if you're only speaking Spanish, does this make sense in Spanish? And I went and did that work before I started doing my own practice. And so now that I got trained to be a trainer, it applies the same. I mean, I know all the knowledge I have, it's in English, but I am now have that in Spanish. So I don't know. I'm just like super excited because I have like these two worlds in my head that I can use. I don't know how to say that it makes sense, but it's like colliding two worlds. And now you have like a broader vocabulary and a broader concept of everything to help other people get certified and in a perfect, I don't know, in a perfect, I don't want to say in a perfect way because it sounds very.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we'll say in a very valuable way, right? I think we can all agree there, right? Nothing's perfect, but in a very valuable way and meaningful way, we can help people, again, have this tool to apply for their own life, like you did with your mom and with the loss of your husband and with your father, you know, and the work I got to do with the loss of my father and the loss of my cousin and romantic breakups from the past, like, we get to use these tools and then help others. And then, you know, it's so interesting. I remember the first time I was in a training with my dad, and I've been in dozens and dozens of trainings with my dad, right? The first 2 years that I came to the Institute, I literally just traveled the world with my dad doing certification after certification after certification with him. I always daydream that we had a camera crew with us. We couldn't afford that, but I wish I could have shot a documentary on that 2 years. It was so cool because I would just hear him say incredible stuff. He just have these one-off lines he'd never say in another training, but they are really profound at the time. And, you know, one of those times he was like, you know what? I was so naive when I first developed this method. I thought this was just a Western English speaking problem. I just assumed everyone else on the world knew how to do grief, knew how to, you know, had a grief process at work. And he talked about time and time again, he would be invited from people from other countries, from other continents. And he would go and he would just give the pitch of grief recovery. He'd talk about the myths about grief and he'd talk about the unhelpful information that we pass on in the society. And he was just amazed time and time again that we realized, wow, this is like a global problem, right? We're all falling for a lot of, we're all going down these kind of wrong paths and there's a lot of pitfalls and they're very similar across the world, right? And that's why we can't translate the book fast enough, right? That's why a kind of a big burden on our team is to help with translations, because that's a daunting task. I mean, getting a book, the Grief Recovery Handbook, getting that book into 20 plus languages, that is a bear of a task, right? And it's, by the way, we don't do it for the money. Like, translating a book is not a profitable endeavor for us at all. It's actually each one of them, the amount of time spent in it versus kind of the revenue that's made on a translation is not a positive. It doesn't matter to us though, because we don't want anyone on any continent who wants this book, that sees the value of this book, that wants to do it in their native language. We're not going to let them just kind of not have that, right? Some translations take longer than others. But the fact of the matter is, like, because we're passionate about what we're doing, we want people to be able to do this work in the language that suits them the best, that feels like that's their heart language, right? And so I just want to appreciate your time, Laura, on this podcast. We're kind of running out of time. We're right at the hour long mark. I'm so glad I met you. I'm so glad I got to have the honor of being your instructor early on. I'm so grateful that you approached me and wanted to really help people, Spanish speaking people, have access to these tools and to the certification. And I can't wait to see what you do with this work, you know, at that capacity. So that being said, where can people find you, Laura? You know, how can they work with you? I know the easy answer for me is come get certified in Laura's training. That's how they can work with you. But other ways they can kind of reach out to you, you know, social media, website, like anything you want to promote right now.
Yes, they can follow me on Instagram. It's Laura Rodas SV. And we'll put it on the podcast.
Yeah, we'll put it on. Yeah, we'll put it on the podcast. Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, you can email me. I mean, I'll put all my info right there so that people can follow me. And if someone just wants to go through the method and just work like as an individual, then you can go ahead and do it with me in Spanish.
Perfect. Yeah. Spanish. So they can kind of DM you on Instagram to get in touch with you. And again, that goes for everyone out there listening. If you've listened to a couple of these podcasts and you have emotional pain from the past, which is all of us, you know, and you're curious about this, go find a grief recovery specialist in your area and do this work. You can find them if you go to griefrecoverymethod.com under our programs and you can scroll down and you can see one-on-one work. You can see group work, and that'll take you to directory. So you can find someone in your zip code. If you want to work in person, you can find someone, you know, online that you can work with. And as long as they're in a similar time zone, that works great. But do this work in one way, shape, or form or another. Do this work. If you have If you want to just use the book, that's fine. But like I said earlier in the podcast, you can go a lot deeper with someone trained in this work. So link up with a grief recovery specialist. That means they're trained by us. They have our credential, and we know you're going to have a positive experience because we take this stuff real seriously. And then in addition to that, right, kind of the next level above that is like, no, I love grief recovery, and this is like a passion of mine. You know, look into attending our certification training, right? That's with me or one of another highly trained trainer that's kind of on even a different level. And, you know, people have life-changing experiences, you know, pretty much every weekend with that one. So again, Laura, I want to thank you for your time. I want to thank you for all the work that you do on behalf of the Grief Recovery Method, helping people in this world. And just how I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day, my friend. And thanks for listening, everybody. Please like and subscribe and leave a review, right? If you're listening to this on the Apple platform, please leave a review. Give us 5 stars, leave the review. If you listen to this on Spotify, same thing. That really helps us be found by other people, right? And I know kind of the goal for all of us is to spread this message out there to more people, because we're all hurting a lot in 2024. And unfortunately, a lot of the tools that are out there for grieving people are cover it with drugs. And again, and that's by authorities, not just drug dealers. I would call them kind of the same, but you know, again, I'm ranting. And then a bunch of other bad stuff, right? That a lot of paths we can go down that are not normal, not healthy, not natural. And this one gives you more of a normal and natural way to deal with your pain. So again, thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.